Sarah Popejoy, and we're coming to you live today through a Google Hangout. We've got some really amazing artists who are going to be performing here with you live on Musicians Empowered Song Hour, and we're just really lucky to have them. Annie DeChant, and she's a singer-songwriter from Nashville, Tennessee, but originally from Cleveland, Ohio. Let's not forget the roots. She'll be our first one up performing for us live. So Annie, take it away.
All right, Sarah, thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
Only you could get me to do something so technological.
Those steel-toed boots your daddy wore behind the press on the factory floor are shoes you'll never fill. Roots buried in the ground that brought him comfort and kept him bound, never hold you. I could always tell. So grab your guitar, fire up that Chevrolet. Go play your songs for all the sinners and the saints. This town is gonna break you if you stay. So kiss me goodbye and let me cry while I watch you fly away. Boys round here like fixing cars and drinking beer at Billy's Bar every Friday night. They all say they'll miss your face and your stories lighten up this place. But that them working gloves never fit you right. So grab your guitar, fire up that Chevrolet. We'll all have another ride. Call it a day. We'll still be here when you come back this way. So raise your glass high and say goodbye while we watch you fly away. If you don't go, you'll never know all that you are. It'd be like keeping a butterfly inside a jar. So grab your guitar, fire up that Chevrolet. Go sing your songs for all the sinners and the saints. Life will disappoint you if you stay. So kiss me goodbye and let me cry while I watch you fly away. Yeah, kiss me goodbye and let me cry while I watch you. Away.
Awesome.
Woo!
Awesome.
Thank you.
All right, so I have my little note cards here. So. Okay, so my first question for you, Annie, is, so what's it like, you know, because I know that, you know, I knew you up in Cleveland, Ohio, and How is it different, you know, performing in you know, a town like Nashville, where there's so many songwriters and stuff, versus playing in a, you know, playing it up in northeastern Ohio?
Well, you know, in Cleveland, I was the big fish in a small pond, you know, and things came easily, not easily. I mean, I worked hard, you know, for music. So you can start to feel lost, and also here there are so many of us, the competition is so great that it's rare that you get paid for a gig, and you have to make decisions about the way you want to spend your energy, because you could go all year long playing out for free,
Right,
and using your talent,
easily.
you know. Yeah, you really can. So, you know, I go back to Cleveland, it kind of revitalizes me. It makes me feel, it just gives me confidence and boosts me up, you know, to come back here, because really I'm writing for other people right now, trying to get cuts. But so I guess what you do in a place like this is you find the places where you feel good about where you're playing. Like, I love the Bluebird Cafe shows. I actually
Oh,
play at
yeah.
the Nashville Airport, and I love it there. But you find what feels good to you, you know. Otherwise, I think if you're not selective, you feel lost.
Yeah. Totally feel you there. I played there at the airport. I did that gig once.
It's pretty good.
That's cool. Yeah. So Sarah Beth is also with us today from
Hello.
Dallas. Is now we have a bunch of Nashvillians, and I'm here in Dallas still. But now that she's moved to Nashville. But anyway, so Sarah Beth, you want to take it away?
Yeah, I would love to. And I feel like before I start, like everyone else has their own guitar, but I'm awful and you would not want to hear me play guitar for myself. So my friend Glenn Mitchell is here playing with me today. And he actually plays with me all the time on the road as well. So, anyways, but yeah, this is Miss You Anywhere.
Cool.
Keep me down forever. I'm not gonna let you break my spirit. No, not ever. I'm tired of being lonely lying next to you. Gonna start climbing for the top, but baby, I ain't gonna stop. I wanna start smiling, but there's no denying it's gonna be pain. Strangers in the same house for way too long. Tell me how you're gonna feel coming home and I'm gone, long gone. There's a whole lot of happiness on some mountain with a view. Gonna start climbing for the top, baby, I ain't gonna stop. I wanna start smiling, but there's no denying. It's gonna be pain and it's gonna hurt before it gets better. Being afraid won't keep me here, frozen in time. Gonna offer dear life, gonna walk, gonna drive off the train, gonna fly. My heart's not breaking here. I can miss you anyway. Thank you. pain, yeah, it's gonna hurt before it gets better. Being afraid won't keep me here, frozen in time. Oh, all we knew, I'm gonna walk on the time. I'll be trained, gonna fly. I'll wait till I'm breaking here. I can miss you anywhere.
A good song.
Thank you.
So Sarah Beth, your tour kicks off February 6th with Lone Star. Tell me a little bit about this tour.
Well, I'm really excited about this tour, and it's just acoustic. So Glenn, of course, will be there, and then Kristen Cole, who is another phenomenal musician that any time that we play, besides tonight, actually, really, Kristen's always with us. But it's just going to be the three of us, and we're going to be going into Arizona and California, and then we'll finish up on the East Coast in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, that area. And so I'm really excited, but that's kind of what February and March holds for us. And so I'm incredibly excited about it. We all are.
That sounds exciting. Sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Like a lot of fun.
It'll be really fun for the music, and then for also, like, Kristen, I know my other guitar player has never been to Arizona or California, so she just loves experiencing new things. So I actually just can't wait to go to new states with her. That's going to be a blast.
Oh yeah, most definitely. Well, all right. So and by the way, I want to mention before I because I want to mention this several times during the show that we've got links to everybody's website and also their music, so definitely go down there and just go a little bit down on the page down there and click on their website, support them, buy their music as well, and you can see any of their tour dates and stuff like that as well. And so next we have Hannah Aldridge and Americana. And Hannah, you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. All right.
Okay.
So you ready?
I'm ready. I'm gonna play a one called Razor Wire, if that's cool with you.
Hard-earned mistakes look well rehearsed from the stands. I sit outside of that pawn shop crying, holding that ring in my hand. Feel old. cheap cigarettes. When I get good and lonely, I'll follow him home. Let there be blur in that line that we've drawn. But he said he don't think I love anything much. And I hope to God he ain't right. Oh, I miss you sometimes. I'm so lonesome and I'm so tired. Wrecking myself and wrecking my mind. Hanging by razor wire. Oh, I miss you tonight. I'm so lonesome, I feel like I'm dying. Leaves you with razor wire. Oh, I'm hanging by razor wire.
Yay!
Nice.
Love it. Nice.
I love your voice, Hannah.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Sounds great.
That was awesome.
Thank you. All right.
Okay, so Hannah.
Yes.
What was it, my little note cards here. What was it like, your dad is a famous songwriter, Walt Aldridge. And so what was it like growing up with a dad who wrote songs all the time and, you know, being a songwriter yourself? How did that, what was that like?
Well, it's funny because I did not start writing songs until I was 21. And most people think that, you know, I must have just come out of the crib writing songs because my dad wrote songs. And actually, it was kind of the opposite. I was very intimidated to do music because he, you know, was such a great songwriter and was so good at it. And it's a little intimidating to, start writing songs whenever your dad is, you know, doing it on a large scale. It's kind of like, how would I ever live up to that? So, you know, it was a little intimidating. And I know even as a kid, I played piano and did a lot of talent shows, and I just refused to let my dad hear me practicing and stuff. Because I just was very intimidated of, you know, playing in front of him. But, you know, it's one of those things where I think people kind of just assume that, you know, when he came home from work, which was writing songs, when he would come home, that we would all just gather around the piano like the Partridge Family and sing or something. And it was quite the opposite. I kind of compare it to people who, you know, do software design all day. I highly doubt that those people come home and just for fun do software design when they get home from work. You know, it's like, that's kind of the way he was, and he didn't really come home and play music very much because he was doing it all day. And it's funny because it's the same way that I am now. I just very rarely, when I'm not playing a show or on the road or writing, I don't really sit around and play the guitar very often just because I want to, you know, because usually if I have time free, it's not going to be spent doing music. So long story short, I think it was very different than what people might assume it was like. It was, for a long time, I really didn't even know exactly how my dad even wrote songs because I didn't really see that process very often. So,
oh, thank you. Thanks for sharing that. I think
you're welcome.
I think I have a interest in I don't know performers whose parents were also either performers or because my dad he was an artist and so I always had a strong, you know, we always had that connection, because so I always wonder what other people's, you know, connections are like when, you know, they share the same you know, gift or talent. So.
Yeah, I think it's, anyway. It's really different for everybody. I think it depends on the particular person. I know people that that has been a really great, wonderful thing for them, and I know people that it's been kind of hard, and I think I fall somewhere in between because I think very often people assume a lot of things, like that my dad just gives me everything or has done everything for me, and that is the total opposite. He certainly has influenced me and helped me and really helped me build my craft and try to help me be a better writer in general, but he has never one time just given me something, you know, in terms of an opportunity. He makes me work for that, you know, the same way that he did. And I think it depends on the person, because some parents that are musicians might not be like that. You know, they might be a little bit more apt to kind of do everything for the kid. And I just think it's different for everyone. But for me, that's been my experience with it, is that it was, I've really had to find my own path with it. And really even coming to the idea of being a musician was not something my dad was super fond of. And so, you know, I had to even convince him to do that. So I think it's just different for everybody, you know.
Yeah, yeah, most definitely. Well, cool. All right. Annie, you ready to share another song with us?
Yeah, I'm doing a couple new ones tonight, so.
Before you start, I am going to ask you this. Are you going to play Swing tonight?
Oh, I will, if you want me to. I haven't played that in a while, but I will.
It's really awesome song.
Thanks.
Okay.
Sure. Anyway, this is a new one that I wrote with my buddy David G. Smith. He's getting ready to release a new CD. But anyway, I'm not sure. I don't think I need to tell you. I shouldn't need to tell you anything about this. Anyway, it's called Sunday Morning Drive. Sunday morning after church, my daddy piled us in the car. Me and my brother was in the back. He'd turn on the game, catch the play-by-play coming from the bar. Mama opened up a map. We never had a clue about where we were going. She'd smile and say half the fun was not knowing. And we'd ride, 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 arms hanging out the window, for miles and miles under a big Kentucky sky. Past bluegrass fields, cornrows and tobacco, life looked beautiful, rolling by on that Sunday morning ride. We'd pull off to a Texaco, eat lunch and drink Kool-Aid from a jar. Daddy let me pump the gas. Sometimes we'd see a license plate from out of state, a family in the car. Kids staring out the back. One time I met a blue-eyed boy from Idaho. There's still a piece of my heart out on that road, where we'd ride, 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 arms hanging out the window, for miles and miles under a big Kentucky sky, past bluegrass fields, cornrows and tobacco, life looked beautiful, rolling by on that Sunday morning drive. Say you can go back to the good times you once had, but sometimes I close my eyes and
And I hear my brother laughing. See Dad behind the wheel while he's holding Mama's hand. And we ride, ride, ride. Drums hanging out the window. Miles and miles under a blue Kentucky sky. Past bluegrass fields, cornrows and tobacco. Life looks beautiful, rolling by. On that Sunday morning, bright.
Nice, Annie, nice.
Thank you.
That's really nice.
Annie, I'm doing tweets right now, and I just tweeted that you remind me of Mary Gautier a little bit.
Have you ever heard
that before?
And you want to know what? This is funny, because David, who wrote that song with me, Mary sings on his CD, on his last CD.
Oh, really?
His latest CD. Yeah, they're good friends. She kind of became a mentor to him. He loves her.
She's amazing.
She is amazing. So, thanks for that.
You're welcome.
That's cool. All right. So, anyways, okay. Recently you were in a movie. Well, you weren't in a movie, but your song was in a movie.
Yeah.
And you attended the red carpet of Hot Flashes.
Yep.
And so what was that experience like, you know, being on the red carpet to the premiere?
It was like crazy. I mean, I guess it's like what you imagine. I mean, you literally walk out on, well, it was a pink carpet because they were raising money for breast cancer research. And you have all these people, paparazzi, calling out your name, trying to get you to look at them, you know. I was treated so well by the people involved in the movie. Brad Hennig, the writer, Nina, who was one of the producers. You know, it was all inclusive. So it was hilarious. I mean, it was strange and, you know, you just start like posing for these cameras and walking, and then you see like Brooke Shields and Daryl Hannah and Cameron Mannheim, Wanda Sykes. We met all of them. We sat next to them, talked with them. I will tell you though, to be in a theater watching a movie and hear your song come on is a thrill. I think I spoke to an architect recently, and I thought that his description of what makes him most happy about his work is like what I just said, like when you hear your song in a film. He said, when I design a building and they build it and I get to walk into it, I thought that was like the perfect sort of analogy, you know, for me, like that was how it felt. It couldn't be bad, you know what I mean? It was just a wonderful experience. You're in LA, you know, and you're going to this movie premiere. So it was great.
Oh, neat. I can just imagine what that would feel like, you know, being in a movie theater for the first time and all of a sudden it's your song. It had to be wonderful.
It's your song and Wanda Sykes is sitting three rows in front of you and Cameron Mannheim sitting one row in front of you. Brooke Shields is down a little further. Like, I mean, that alone is kind of crazy.
Yeah, really cool. All right. So next up, Sarah Beth. It's your turn again.
Sweet. This is actually my single that shipped to radio yesterday. So this is a song called That's the Sound.
Jingling in my hands, 3-inch heels on a hardwood floor.
the open road, going where the white lines lead. Let me breathe and listen to the sound of freedom. Freedom, that's the sound. Birds singing in the yard, gravel moving underneath my feet, revving in a worn out car, burning a rubber on a black Gulf Stream. That's the sound of the heart letting go.
That's going to radio. When did you say that's going to radio?
That actually went to radio yesterday. So it shipped out to radio yesterday, and it is officially my current single.
Sweet. So everybody, call your local radio station, and it's called The Sound of Freedom.
It's called That's the Sound.
What's it called?
Yes. Call That's the Sound.
That's the Sound.
Yes. So yes.
Okay. So everybody, call your local. Most definitely. Okay, Hannah, I've muted you, and I can't figure out how to unmute you. All right.
I got it.
So, you got it? Okay, good.
Yep.
I was a little worried I'd mess something up there. All right. So, okay. So, okay. All right. So, Sarah Beth, your new album, Anything Is Possible, was produced by it's Dean Sams of Lone Star, and you collaborated with some respected Nashville songwriters as well. How has this experience helped you? Do you feel like it's helped you grow as an artist, or what was that experience like?
Overwhelming, I think, is the best way to put it, because whether it has been writing with Dean, who obviously is in Lone Star, and an enormous amount of respect for him and all that he's accomplished, or even writing with Glenn, who's playing guitar for me tonight, because he's had some phenomenal cuts. He wrote Living Our Love Song with Jason Michael Harrell. That's correct, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, he's had cuts with Lone Star and cuts with Darius Rucker as well. And, writing with people like that, it's songs that you have listened to on the radio or on people's records, and it's really humbling to get to, you move to a town and you start writing with people that have these songs, and it really is overwhelming, and it's intimidating for sure. But a blast all at the same time. And you learn a lot.
Yeah.
Like you learn a lot from every time you write with anyone, but I never in my wildest dreams thought that I would write with hit songwriters.
That's cool. That's really neat.
Yeah.
All right. So Hannah, you're next up to bat.
Right. Well, I too am playing a whole bunch of new songs. I just finished cutting a record, and so I'm test driving a bunch of new songs off the record. So if I mess up, then I blame it on that.
I miss you like morphine, straight to my veins. No, I shouldn't be here, but I'm here anyway. I swear I'll be gone. Sun hits your eyes. If you don't mind, I'd like you to love me tonight. I know you don't need me the way I need. Just for my sake, can you say that you do? Cause I don't need roses, hell, I don't need wine. All that I need, should I like you love me tonight? I like you love me, and you don't know the truth. Better without me. You. Oh, that I still have your love, and you still want mine. So just for old times, I like you love me tonight.
There's another real sad song for y'all.
I hear a Disney song.
Do what?
I was feeling
it's all Disney. Disney.
Oh well, thank you very much.
I was feeling a little Mike Reed, Bonnie Raitt combo of I Can't Make You Love Me, right there.
Yeah. Oh well, Please. that is a huge compliment. That's one of my favorite songs of all time. So. I've got, I don't always just sit around cool. And drink tea. Like, I'm super prestigious. I just have kind of a sore throat today.
We know there's really vodka in there.
I am. You know what? There is. And I was actually discussing going over to Sarah Best because I hear that they have whiskey over there. So I was thinking, now that my turn is done, I'm going to drive over to her house. So for my next turn, I'm going to be over there, if that's
okay. Hey, that's so not me. That's all of my guitar player. All my guitar player.
Oh, come on, Sarah Beth.
Yeah, I hear that that helps sore throats as well.
No, surprisingly, we actually had a show in England last week, and I had no voice when I landed in the UK. And Glenn's, like, treatment for me was just drink a little bit of whiskey before you go on stage and you'll be fine. And surprisingly, I was fine.
You're making me out to be a bad influence.
Yeah, I know. That's usually what happens when you drink whiskey, is you're under the illusion that you're fine, but you're not. That's
right.
That goes. I thought I was fine, and
you
it was great.
You were fine to drive, too, right?
I was fine to drive. It really was. I was just sipping on
it. Same rule of thumb. If you're fine to drive and you're fine to sing karaoke, you're fine. That's usually the way. If I can stand up and sing karaoke, I probably don't need to be driving. That's usually the way. Those two things cannot exist in the same night.
Driving and karaoke.
Cheers. No, never.
Cheers to you and your hot tea mug.
Yeah. It's not hot.
All right. So Hannah, on your website, your music is classified as Americana, but it also as being part of that muscle shoal sound. Explain to us kind of what that is.
Well, you know what, that is a really difficult answer or question to answer, and I really need to come up with a better one because I don't know how to answer that. It's kind of, it's one of those things that's just,
well, you can
there's
tell
a certain
right now cuz
well, there's well, somebody I out there is watching know. And they're going to be like, "Hannah is such an idiot. She just said something so stupid about muscle shoals." That, you know, the thing about muscle shoals is there are a lot of sounds to it, really. But I think when people think of the muscle shoal sound, they think of, you know, in the 70s, and they were cutting things like Aretha Franklin over there, and even they cut a Cat Stevens record over there. And, you know, it's just, I think people kind of think of this real retro sound, which was true for a little while, and then during the 90s, there was a big, I wouldn't say big, but there were quite a few writers that came out of Muscle Shoals that were writing big hits because they weren't in Nashville, and it was a little bit different. And then in the 2000s, now there have been a bunch of artists that have come out of there. There's the Civil Wars that came out of there, and there's the Alabama Shakes. A couple of them are from there, and Jason Isbell, 400 Unit, and the Secret Sisters, and a couple other bands that have just done well, and I'm sure I'm leaving some out too, but you know, it's just kind of been this revolving door of music, and it's been interesting because recently it's kind of changed a little bit. Before, it was more about being the recording capital of the world, and then it kind of became a songwriting haven, and now it's kind of become this place that there's a lot of cool artists coming out of there because, again, it's so close to Nashville, but it's not, you know, it's not Nashville. It just doesn't – nobody that comes from Muscle Shoals sounds like Nashville. And so I don't know. I guess that's kind of a vague answer for you, but it's – you know, I would say anybody who has any interest in Muscle Shoals, there's a documentary out about it. It really is pretty amazing to see even somebody like me that grew up there and was right in the middle of all of it. I didn't even realize some of the stuff that was going on and how cool it was. And some of the people that are from there that I know, I didn't realize how cool their careers had been. And so, anyways, it's a really interesting little town. And what makes it interesting, I guess, is that there have been a lot of music towns that have kind of ceased to exist musically, like Chicago and Detroit and some of those places, you know, that not that they don't exist musically, but, you know, there were such huge meccas at some point, even Memphis, you know. And the difference is that somehow the people in Muscle Shoals have kind of kept that stigma alive about it being the music capital of the world and it being, I mean, recording capital of the world, and it, you know, we've kind of managed to still make that happen somehow, and that's the kind of cool thing about it. So, I don't know, do a little digging around about it. It's a pretty cool little place.
Hmm. Yeah, most definitely, most definitely. Well, thank you for educating us, at least
well,
me.
There's a lot,
you know, honestly,
believe
I was surprised that I didn't know.
I was going to say, I'll probably get some crap from somebody about that answer because there's some people out there that could give you a really great answer about it. But, you know, being from there, I should be able to give you a great answer to that question. But it's kind of, you know, my experience even is a little different than maybe some other people. So.
All right. Okay, so, Annie, what you going to play for us next?
Well, you know, I'm going to do swing because you asked about it.
But
I wanted to tell you too, I've spent some time in Muscle Shoals playing down there, gone to Fame Studios and, you know, seen what's going down there. I actually gave my lead guitarist Pete from Cleveland tickets to that Muscle Shoals show. You know, I guess I think, like, the thing that sticks out about Muscle Shoals is it seems to me like the heart and soul of what's going on at the time. Like, it always changes, but it seems like, you know, the Civil War is right now. You know, they were produced there. And it's sort of like this, it seems to me like these groups that come from sort of under the radar, you know, and then they shape what everybody else is doing. Like, I heard a producer speak recently, and he said, we always follow Muscle Shoals, you know, what's going on there.
Yeah.
And it's incredible to me, because if you go to the town of Muscle Shoals, like Florence, when you're there, if you're there just driving around, I think that you would guess that nothing's going on, because...
Absolutely.
The area's pretty depressed.
That's the real interesting thing about it. It's very, I mean, just finding it on a map is difficult. And even, you know, just I think what you're saying is very true about it being something that is constantly changing. It's whatever is kind of hip at the moment.
Yeah.
And I think that's been a group effort by all the people that live in Muscle Shoals to kind of keep it cutting edge, you know, and to constantly be exploring what is outside of Nashville, but what is still in the box, you know, and I don't know. I think you're right about that, though, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, like, if you were there as someone who didn't know anything about the history, I don't know that you would think that anything was going on there. You know what I mean? Like, unless you're inside those studios, you would not know that. I mean, it seems like an area that was hard hit, you know, by I don't know what, but hard hit, and still somehow it's churning out this music that everybody's so thrilled with, you know, and happy to try to copy. I don't know how you feel about that, Hannah.
Yeah,
but,
right. Well, I think, you know, it's interesting because if you take just the Civil Wars, for example, they're a great example of what we're talking about, because John Paul was signed with my dad for his first publishing deal, and he's the guy in the group.
Yep.
And whenever he was first signed was in the 90s when we were talking about there being a songwriting thing going on. And so, you know, I think that he kind of even evolved as an artist. They didn't just come out the Civil Wars, you know. I mean, John Paul was writing as a staff writer for my dad down there in Muscle Shoals during the songwriting era, I suppose. And then, you know, he kind of just personally evolved with it. So I think it's kind of everybody that does it on their own accord, you know. So.
Yeah, I feel like there's a circle there that I'm not a part of. But, you know what I mean? I mean, honestly, I think that has to be true. And I hope that the more that I visit there, the more that I'll meet people and, you know, talk with them and see and be involved in even more of that side of it. So it's a pretty incredible place, mm-hmm. and I'm looking forward to seeing that movie too.
Yeah, it's very neat.
All right, well, I'm going to play Swing for you now. At long last.
Yay.
Here we go. This is the one I've pitched to some artists. It seems to me the first couple lines are a little too graphic for them, which is incredible based on some of the video games I see. But anyway, this is the title track of my latest CD. This is Swing. I'm like that boxer in the ring. My blood is on the man. Eyes swollen shut. And nobody thinks I'm getting up. All these cuts and bruises can make you feel like hell. Sometimes I think I'll lay here and wait on the bell. But then I hear a voice down deep inside of me telling me one more time, get back on your feet. And life is standing there staring back at me. It might knock me down, but falling is part of having dreams. And when I'm thrown a curve, the most important thing is that I clench my fist, pull back my arm, and swing. I'm like that batter at the plate. It's the bottom of the ninth. Base is loaded up, and nobody thinks I got the stuff. This game of mostly missing can cut you to the core, make you wonder what you're doing it for. But then I hear the laughter of a 7-year-old kid. And I recall when I played for the joy of it. And life is standing there staring back at me, reminding me striking out is part of having dreams. And when I'm thrown a curve, the most important thing is that I stand up tall, pull back my arms and swing. Life is standing there staring back at me. It might knock me down, but falling is part of having dreams. And through all the ups and downs, the most important thing is that I clench my fist, pull back my arm, and
thank you so much.
No problem. Sorry about that last note.
Oh, that's all right. You know, blame it on the beer. I really love that song, Annie. I really love how you compared the two. It's just it's really really cool analogy there. It's really inspires me.
Good,
I feel
you.
Like Rocky after I've heard that song. I cannot believe that it's getting close. It's already 9 o'clock.
Wow.
And I know. I cannot believe it's 9 o'clock. This went by so fast, but this may need to be longer. But anyways, I just want to thank everybody who watched, and I especially want to thank everyone. I want to thank you, Annie DeChance, Sarah Beth, and Hannah. Thank you so much for joining on this Google Hangout. It was such a pleasure to be able to hear each and every one of you sing, and with your enormous talent, and I know y'all have so much further to go with it as well. So to our viewers who are watching, make sure that you buy their albums down there. Look below the screen. There should be some links to places to purchase their music, and you can join our emailing list as well, either as a musician or as a music listener. And we'll definitely have to do this again, and I hope you all will join me again sometime too. This was really great.
Sarah, thank you so much for inviting us and for doing this.
Yeah, thank you for having us on. We appreciate it. I wish
welcome.
That every show I could do from my home, because nobody else knows this, but now they do. I have pajamas on from the waist down, and I would really love to be able to do that on a daily basis. If we could make that happen, I would really like to just stream all of my shows on here, and I'll just do them from the waist up.
And that's why you're my hero, Hannah. Thank you guys again, and to everybody out there, see you next time.